because it's subject to NAFTA, so this is not applicable. Everyone sees why? Next. United States? No. It didn't get acquire a US origin. Hong Kong? No. It was a raw fabric yarn. NA NAFTA, this doesn't exist. Because this NA relates to the free trade agreement. There is no country NAFTA. It's just an agreement between three countries. So, marking. So besides 181, marking is another provision which you need to be mindful of, because country of origin is rules. They are different from those rules which require for marking purposes. So you have NAFTA country of origin, let's say Mexico, and then you must engage in a separate determination for marking purposes. And that engagement is found in section 102, 19 CFR, 102. Just a little refresher about containers. Remember that the usual containers, what's the usual container? Container is the one that's commonly used with that article. Country of origin marking is not required, so you don't need to worry about labeling made in Canada if it's a container. But you have to make sure the articles are labeled. But if containers are imported empty, if containers are imported empty, then additional proof may be required, such as, okay, what do you do? Do you fill them up? Do you fill up those Coca-Cola bottles with Coca-Cola, for example? Show me the process of production. Show me the documents. Next. Now we get to the General Note 12. Harmonized Tariff Schedule. HTSUS, General Note 12. Strictly speaking, from legal perspective, what's more important, Harmonized Tariff Schedule or Code of Federal Regulations? And why? This is HTSUS. It comes directly from the Congress. Code of Federal Regulations comes directly from Customs. What Customs does, they take the law from Congress, then they reapply it and make the regulations out of the law and adopt it in the Code of Federal Regulations. So Harmonized Tariff Schedule, or HTSUS, has more weight because it's closer to the democratic principles than the Code of Federal Regulations. That may be helpful with certain things as you dwell on in your career, but keep that difference in the back of your head, because HTSUS, although it repeats many same things, it is different body of law. So when you look at the General Note 12, you may be asked to determine the value qualifier for NAFTA. And how will that be done? Let's take a look at the General Note 12. And so this is General Note 12. I just put it somewhere in the middle. And let's pick a more familiar chapter. Chapter 40, chapter 12, let's do the 39. So chapter 39. So you have a product which is an article of plastic. It is in chapter 39. You need to determine, given certain factors of production, if the product qualifies for NAFTA country. What do? You go to the general note 12, T, this is all under T, so GN 12T, and you go to the chapter 39, and then you have the statement. A change to heading 3901-3920 from any other heading, including another heading within that group, provided the regional value content is not less than, and there comes the magic words, transaction value method, net cost method. So what is transaction value method? Well, before we even go there, what is that? Change to heading 3901 through 3920. What does that mean? That means that in order for the product to qualify for NAFTA, you have to have a change from, let's say, a molecule, right? This is like, let's say, molecular formula, right? You have to change it, let's say it's somewhere in chapter 27, which is organic or inorganic chemicals. You have to transform it to chapter 39 in Mexico or in Canada or in the United States, and the value of your operations must be either 60% or 50%, depending on what methodology you use. So the question is, what is that methodology? What is transaction value? What is net cost value? Okay, stop. Everyone take a deep breath. I notice that people are falling asleep because NAFTA is much, how should I say this? It's much dry and it's much difficult topic as it may sound. It's really, once you get the basic concept, it's really easy. And customs examiners, they just tend you to test you on over and over and over on the same stuff again and again. So this stuff, relatively easy to grasp. The only challenge here is that it requires you, there is rules, and you need to learn how to imply them instead of fill in the blanks, most of the stuff. So that's the only trouble, because given the information you have, the last thing you need is just to get creative at the end of the day. You're struggling to get grasp of all the other stuff. But here, let's go back here. Here, this is straightforward. This is more like fill in the blank. And here is the reason why. Because the transaction value and net cost method value, first of all, you're free to choose either formula. It's number one. You're free to choose it. Why? Because recall that, why would you want to choose it? Because one formula is 60%, another formula is 50%. So if one disallows it, let's say under net cost method, you cannot qualify it for NAFTA, but under transaction value method, you can, or the vice versa. You can pick and choose. And so long as your calculations are legitimate, you can qualify it for NAFTA and take advantage of the duty-free rate, preferential duty rate. And how do you calculate it? Well, it's input of those numbers. You have regional value content, which is usually refers to the domestic value, like stuff of Mexico, or stuff of Canada, or stuff of the United States. And you have transaction value. We all talked about transaction value, just for FOB. What's FOB? Freight on board, another Inca term, which very commonly met. And you put those factors into this formula, and you have the number. And you calculate, is it 60% or 50%, which is required? If it's more or at that number, then you're good. You can claim NAFTA. Well, almost, right? There are other things. Or there is net cost method. Notice, you're kind of constrained if there is no transaction value. Remember, transaction value is the price actually paid or payable. The problem is that if the transaction value is not available, let's say it's a related party transaction, and you must use computer's value or the deductive value, then you kind of stuck with the net cost. But if you have transaction value, then you can pick and choose either or at your convenience. De minimis. What's a de minimis? De minimis is a minimum amount that, because it's so little, it can be disregarded. So, generally speaking, 7% is the borderline. Usually 7% applicable to other trade agreements. So let's say if you have 7% of the input, you don't even worry about it. You can disregard it. So let's say you have 7%, I already raised it, of the Chinese product. Everything else, otherwise it qualifies for Mexico, but it has a 7% input. You don't worry about it because it's so small, it's minuscule. And of course, the biggest challenge here is the 7% de minimis rule is subject to multiple exceptions. And those exceptions, I try to list them here. Most of them deal in the world of agricultural products. There are some appliances as well. I believe there is also some, I did not include them here. I believe there is also some for the textiles. So, this is when we get to the tariff shifting, general note 12T. GN12T, tariff shifting, here is what it looks like. I think I overshot. That's where it starts. And you see all those chapters all the way to the 39 that we talked about. So let's take a break and then we'll talk about the tariff shifting after the break. So customs examiners come to you on the day of the exam and they say, you see this little thing? We call it a clamp. Well, tell us, does it qualify for the free trade agreement or not? And then give you this fact pattern. They have a stainless steel clamp from Canada. But it's not really from Canada. It can come from Spain. And they use the slanted cost phrase, $2. Canadian importer. So they bring a clamp without a bolt. In Canada, they added the bolt and washers. You cannot see it in the picture. But by the way, they will not give you the picture. They will just give you this fact. It's just my imagination. And someone's thoughtful photograph. And so they give you the description of the cost. They give you this the statement that it comes from Spain. Then it comes from so Spain to Canada. Just a thought. Remember when you declare country of origin for Canada, What letters do you use? Do you use CA? No. You use the province, remember? CA you use to claim preferential duty treatment. CA you use to indicate this is NAFTA. But otherwise you stick to the, like, if it's British Columbia, you say BC. Country of origin is BC. And how you construct the manufacturer code? BC. That you start with the first two letters from the province. Yeah? Alright. So, let's go back to our question. So, Spain, Canada, United States. So, bolt is two doors, claim body is two doors. So let's see, you have a clamp. This would be my picture of clamp. Let's say this is a clamp. A clamp body, right? Two bucks. Then it comes from Spain. Then you have bolt and washers. And the bolt, so you have a bolt, and you have washers. Bolt is a US, washers are Canadian, and they also two doors each, very expensive ones, very nice ones probably, two doors each, right? And the purpose of this is to provide constant tension needed to counteract expansion and construction of the hose or pipe connections for the diesel engine. So they will be part of the diesel engine. And then they say something else. They say the diesel engine, so you have this, let's say engine, right? This is engine. So all the stuff go in and this engine is not part of the motor vehicle. It can be, the reason for this can be because diesel engine can be used for, let's say, vessel, like a marine engine. It can be used as a generator diesel engine, or it can be just doesn't qualify as a matter of law because it fails certain provisions. For us, it doesn't matter. This just states does not qualify as part of accessory of a motor vehicle. So it's not part of cars. All right. So then they say, what's the classification and duty rate for the product? So now here you need to do two things. You need to determine classification and you need to determine the duty rate. And custom examiners give you five choices. The first, they give you the HTS numbers. Then they give you SPI. What's SPI, anyone? What's SPI stand for? Special Product Indicator. It's a code which identifies. So the label, you remember, how do you declare NAFTA? You say SPI, Special Product Indicator. CA, Canada, or Mexico, MX. So if you say CA, then NAFTA applies. If you say CA, then NAFTA applies. If you don't say that, then NAFTA does not apply. And so what do you do? Do you start, what do you do? You, obviously you can see that this is the bolded answer is correct answer, but what's, how do we get to that answer? Where do we start? What's the first thing we do? We start with, we know the picture, right? We understand the operations. The goal is to apply these operations to get the right answer.